Next to Popeye and General So, Colonel Sanders is arguably the most famous military figure ever to be associated with fast food chicken. Much like his secret blend of 11 herbs and spices, however, information regarding the Colonel's origins remains shrouded in mystery. Some say he was the unwanted progeny of General Robert E. Lee and a young slave girl by the name of Aunt Jemima. Others believe he'd been abandoned in the woods by Kentucky Hill people in an attempt to appease their coal god.
Born and raised in the backwoods, barefoot on the farm. The hammer of life, it's heavy. You looked up and your paw was gone.
All that is known is that one cold December day in '01, Mary Sanders found a naked 10-year-old boy nestled in among her prize-winning chickens. Even stranger, the young child was unable to speak and would only cluck incessantly. But the Sanders family took pity on the wee voodoo child and adopted him as one of their own, despite his habit of pecking at his new brothers and sisters.
Something's gotten hold of my heart, keeping my soul.
They named him Harland and raised him with all the love, kindness, and chicken feed he needed, and over time he slowly learned to speak like humans do. Harland also became quite skilled at the culinary arts, a talent that would prove useful to him later in life.
You can get it if you really want. You can get it if you really want. You can get it if you really want, but you must try.
At the age of 16, Harland set out on his own to find his way in the world. Always the ambitious go-getter, he tried to start several businesses, but was as successful as a piano tuner in a trailer park.
Piano tuner?
I ain't got no piano, but I reckon my radio needs a tuning.
He started with a horse painting and detailing business, but it failed due to the widespread popularity of the automobile. Then came his German restaurant, which he unfortunately opened on the eve of World War I. Desperate for money, he took a job as a sideshow geek with the Ringling Brothers Circus and toured the country biting off the heads off of live chickens.
The Colonel was really breaking some new ground back then and really paved the way for me to bite the edge off bats.
Betty.
I think that he was really responsible for the success that I had or became, that and the drugs.
I know my chicken, you got to know your chicken. I know my chicken, you got to know your chicken.
Sanders was a natural at it and soon elevated the once arcane parlor trick into a modern art form. Harland even became so popular he left the circus to become a solo act. Jump ahead to the year 1952.
I've been driving all night, my hands wet on the wheel. There's a voice in my head that drives my heel.
America was on the go, and many's a traveler passing through Kentucky on old Route 25 stumbled across a curious sight. A strange old man by the side of the road in an immaculate white suit biting the heads off of live chickens. It was Harland Sanders in his Nobel Prize-winning act, drawing in record crowds all the way from eastern Kentucky to slightly east of central Kentucky.
There was someone waiting to help and rescue you. Just call for super chicken.
Then, one afternoon, after a hard day of geeking, Sanders was driving home with his truck full of headless chicken carcasses and approached this rope bridge which spanned Old Lardy, the mysterious Kentucky River of boiling lard. While crossing the gangplank, the suspension gave way, and as Harlan plunged the 40 feet below, two things happened that would change his life forever. First, the headless chickens fell into the boiling lard, which created a unique variety of fried chicken that was crispy, tender, and strangely finger-licking good. The accident also gave Harlan a massive brain hemorrhage, causing him to believe he was a Confederate officer in the Civil War. A demented Harlan now began calling himself Colonel Sanders and pledged to open a chain of restaurants to sell his delicious new chicken and with rounding up his runaway slaves to work in these restaurants.
The South must rise up again to defeat the insidious threat of that Yankee McDonald's.
Sanders' first restaurant serving chicken prepared the Colonel's way wasn't a success initially. Apparently, the Colonel's way consisted of Sanders personally choking each of his own chickens. Then, before deep frying, he dragged the warm carcasses through piles of roadside dirt, gravel, and broken glass, which he called his 10 herbs and spices. Of course, the concoction tasted bilious, even to the unsophisticated palate of the backwoods Kentuckian.
Lordy Lord, this tastes like there's a burning tire in my mouth.
But when the Colonel added the secret 11th ingredient, essentially a crap load of MSG, the name Colonel Sanders was thrust into the pantheon of gourmets like Chef Boyardee, Bob's Big Boy, and that Lucky Charms leprechaun. Hundreds of his restaurants began popping up around the country, and the Colonel's face was on every sign, every bucket of chicken, and even on every roll of restroom toilet paper.
Yes, sir. Extra crispy.
I know my chicken. You got to know your chicken.
He'd pull surprise inspections on his franchises, and if he discovered a local owner who didn't use his secret recipe, had unclean facilities, or didn't answer him with either, yes, sir, or no, sir, he'd beat them with his hickory cane. Years later, Shug Knight, owner of the Compton KFC franchise, would copy this same management style to revolutionize the rap industry. As the years went by, the Colonel got older and his chicken empire became as difficult to handle as a midget with a bullwhip. He wanted out and was approached by a group of Arab investors from Kuwait. Flush with new money off of skyrocketing oil prices, the Arabs were eager to do business with the Colonel because they mistakenly believed he was the leader of the U.S.'s armed forces. He offered him $3 billion in cash and a free bucket of chicken for the franchise, and the Colonel immediately accepted. The Kuwaitis learned that Sanders had no real military power and was just some guy who resembled Tom Wolfe's retarded grandpappy. They set out to ruin the Colonel's name and prestige. They renamed the franchise Kuwaiti Fried Chicken, and that's not all they changed. Instead of lard, they now deep-fried the chicken in high-octane gas, and instead of the secret blend of 11 herbs and spices, the Kuwaitis now breaded the chickens in one spice, pure evil. This betrayal of all his hard work left the Colonel extremely bitter during his later years.
What advice would you have for young people watching our show today?
I'll kill you. I'll kill everybody here, especially you, Mike Douglas.
You got to know your chicken. I know my chicken.
While unfortunately the Colonel is no longer with us, since KFC's board of directors had Sanders drawn, quartered, and deep-fried in 1980, his bitter dying hope to kill us all may someday come true. According to recent information from the U.S. Health Department, the Colonel's fried chicken is now the fifth largest killer of people in the U.S., more than crack, heavy metal music, and the CIA combined. Now that's finger-licking good.
Nobody sells chicken like the Colonel.
Attention, armchair dictators and living room couch professors. Liebography needs your help in deciding whose character we should assassinate for next month's show. Call 212-714-8011 or visit our website and tell us which celebrity halfwit or historical towhead you'd like us to slander. Our staff of comedy monkeys await your suggestions. Please vote now before you're too drunk to remember.
Ladies and gentlemen, our special guest,